Hi all. Well, today we're going to talk about the famous exterior algebra of a linear space Vn, where n is the dimension of the linear space. Now, the reason it's called exterior is because we're going to use the vectors in Vn to construct objects, exterior products, which do not belong to the space Vn, so they're exterior to the space. The exterior algebra is constructed from any linear space Vn, and the exterior algebra is a 2n dimensional linear space denoted by, you know, this kind of capital wedge acting on Vn. Wedge Vn is called the exterior product space of Vn, and this object, wedge Vn, is a linear space. Now, the thing that the exterior algebra does is it gives us a way of multiplying together vectors. You know, regular linear spaces have addition of vectors, but you can't really multiply them together. So, within the context of linear spaces, combine the linear space with the wedge product, A wedge B, where A and B are vectors in the exterior product space. This gives the exterior algebra. And the exterior algebra is nice because we can not only take products of vectors, products of elements of this exterior product linear space, but when we take those products, we're guaranteed to get back elements of the exterior product space, the exterior algebra. So observe that the wedge product of vectors in the exterior algebra is closed within the linear space wedge Vn. Another property of the exterior product space of Vn is that it consists of n plus 1 subspaces, which are denoted by this exterior power, the P exterior power of Vn, and these are linear spaces, and each one has dimension of the binomial coefficient n P. So this binomial coefficient is showing up because what we're doing is taking the n basis vectors of Vn and selecting p of them at a time and kind of constructing all possible wedge products of collections of p vectors out of the total basis set of Vn, where np is defined for 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 through n. Okay. The vectors in the p exterior power space are called p vectors, and this wedge to the P of Vn is called the pth exterior power space of the linear space Vn. Now, the wedge product that we're going to need to talk about here, one way to look at it is that it is the anti-symmetric tensor product of two vectors in Vn. So, you know, this is a real simple way of getting at the wedge product, where you defined A wedge B as the tensor product AB minus the tensor product BA. Now, we're going to follow a different approach. We don't need to go into tensor algebra. We're simply going to define this product, A wedge B, by a set of abstract algebraic rules. That simplifies the process and makes it self-contained. the basis vectors of Vn. Let's take a look at these basis vectors. So we're going to have a set of n vectors, and we're going to label them E sub k, you know, just the usual way of looking at a basis set of Vn. The basis vectors of Vn are used to construct basis vectors of an exterior power space of Vn. For the P exterior power space are obtained by taking wedge products of elements of the basis of Vn. We're going to show how all this comes about, but we're going to just sort of quickly cover some of the highlights here at the beginning. It's really not very difficult to obtain all of this algebra, but I would say it's, you know, once you've figured it out, it's sort of easy, but if you haven't seen it before, or if you're not really familiar with it, it can look rather mysterious. Why do we get 2 to the n dimensional spaces? You know, how come this wedge product is giving you closure in this big space? Various questions like that pop up. Okay, so let's take a look at the next page. First, we said we were going to define the wedge product between vectors in Vn. Okay. So now let's go ahead with the task of defining the wedge product between vectors in Vn. And notice that this wedge product is going to give you a vector in some other space. It will not be, in general, the wedge product will not be an element of Vn. So here is an abstract definition of the wedge product. For A, B, and C vectors in Vn, and scalars, real numbers, alpha and beta, the wedge product is going to be left associative, right associative, and it has a null product. A wedge A is equal to 0. So let's start up at the beginning here. Left associative means that if you have a sum of vectors alpha A plus B wedge C, the wedge distributes over this vector sum, and you can rewrite this as alpha times A wedge C plus B wedge C. So this is just what you want a normal product to do. Right associative just means that if you do this from the right side, the distributed product over the sum. Okay, now the strange one is that A wedge A is equal to 0. Now, one of the things I've noticed in a lot of treatments of the exterior product, the wedge product, is that they don't really tell you where this 0 is. The 0 you get when you take the product, the wedge product of a vector with itself, is the zero vector in the second exterior power space of Vn. So it's interesting, you can factor the zero vector of the second exterior power space into a product of vectors in Vn. Well, that's equal to 0, but it's the 0 of the fourth exterior power space of Vn. And generally, when you multiply together a bunch of vectors, if you get enough of them together, you're always going to end up producing this 0, but it's going to be kind of a high-dimensional 0. One of the things about exterior power is that when you raise the exterior power greater than n, there are really no vectors left. They vanish. They always give you 0. But you do sort of end up with this tail of 0 spaces extending to higher dimensions. This is a little bit of a diversion, so don't let me be distracted by that. But I find the 0 vector fascinating. So here you go. That's my little thought process here on the zero vector. Now, you may have noticed that there's nothing in these rules that's telling you that A wedge B is equal to minus B wedge A. So you get that right away. Just take A plus B wedge itself. Well, that wedge product is zero by rule three. And then we can use the distributive left and right rules, 2, 1, and 2, to expand this product like this. These two vanish, and you end up with A wedge B plus B wedge A equals zero. And all the elements in this equation are elements of the second exterior power space of Vn. So we say the wedge product is anti-commutative, A wedge B equals minus B wedge A. Another property of the wedge product is that compound wedge products, like say W equals A wedge B wedge C, so on to D, you don't really need to write in the parentheses. And we observe that if you commute adjacent vectors in such a product, so if you take B wedge C out of this product and rewrite it as C wedge B, then that changes the sign of the product. So commutation of adjacent vectors in a product changes the sign of the resulting vector. Okay. Now here's a lemma we can get from rules of the wedge product. Any rearrangement of a non-vanishing compound product is linearly dependent on the original product vector. So, in other words, if you have a compound product that's giving you a vector W, and if you rearrange them, the only thing that happens is the sign changes. You get W, but just the sign can be plus or minus. So, this is handy because it suffices then to describe the action of the wedge on a set of basis vectors of Vn. We don't need to worry about anything more than just getting the algebra of these set of basis vectors of Vn. We need to talk about index and ordering. So we can write this set of basis vectors. It is a cardinality n set. The elements are labeled by k, and k is an element of the index set that we're going to denote by in, and the index set is the set of numbers 1 through n. So we have a unique value of the index for each basis vector in Vn. Vn's n-dimensional, so we have to have n indices to label them uniquely. One of the things about basis vectors that you run into in vector analysis is there are left and right-handed coordinate systems. So the way that that manifests itself by choosing a sequence of these basis vectors and the ordering of the elements in the basis set. So this index set here, you know, this could be taken in any order. There's no order specified by the set of basis vectors. So we will add to this description of the basis the natural ordering of the EK as a sequence where the K is just takes on values 1, 2, 3 through n in sequence from 1 to n. This will take care of making our exterior products, wedge products, unique when we want to calculate the exterior power spaces. So, because we have the ordering I, the ordered index, the directed set I n bar of the basis vectors EK, any subset of the full basis also can be ordered by I n bar. So, you know, this is just saying that if you have a subset of the basis set, then you can line them up in order so that the subset can be converted into an ordered sequence of basis vectors, and these alpha, beta, gamma subscripts are going to be elements of I in bar, and we will have that the ordering comes from I in bar, so we'll just simply have that the number, the natural number alpha is going to be less than beta, is going to be less than so on, less than gamma over here. So that just keeps the product straight. When we construct an exterior product of a subset of basis vectors, we end up with only one product for each subset. We'll talk about this a little bit later. Now here is a lemma. This one is a little bit less, a little bit subtle. So if you have a compound wedge product of any non-empty subset of basis vectors in Vn, the compound product is non-vanishing. You can kind of get a hint that this is probably true. If you take elements of a subset, each of the elements is distinct. Any set must consist of distinct vectors. Hence, all the subproducts of pairs of vectors do not vanish. Hence, no subproduct of a pair vanishes. Now, if you start to have products of pairs, triples, and so on in tuples, you might say that it needs to be proved and established that those type of products also do not vanish as long as the compound wedge product is constructed out of elements of a set of basis vectors, no repeated elements. Clearly, if you have a repeated element in the product, then you can commute the two together and end up with two adjacent vectors that are equal, and that product vanishes. So I can outline the proof here, but I think what we'll do right now is go ahead. So we mentioned this, there's a zero space having a single vector. You know, if Q is greater than N, if the dimension of the original space, then the zero vector exists, but it's a single vector. It's called a zero space. So it sort of vanishes from the discussion. Okay. Well, I think that's enough for right now. What we're going to do next, to the next step in the construction of the exterior algebra, we're going to use a procedure where we characterize the linear space Vn as a fiber bundle over a discrete topological space of basis vectors. And let me just give you a preview of this. So here's an example. Suppose you have the linear space of five dimensions, V5, and the basis vectors, there are five of them, E, K. Well, we can consider them as points in a topological space. It's a discrete space of five elements here. And then we're going to associate each of these points with an instance of the real numbers. So you have these blue arrows. These are schematically the fibers in the fiber bundle. Notice that we can choose a real number associated with each point in the base set. That collection of five numbers is going to be a point in R5, specified by the components alpha 1, alpha 2, through alpha 5. The projection map takes elements from R5 and associates them with the points in the base space, EK, And because we have a vector sum on elements of V5, we can write the sum of the products of the alphas and the basis vectors as a vector in V5. So this is called a fiber bundle, and the fibers are these instances of the real numbers, and there is, in this case, we have a discrete base space of 5 basis vectors, the EK. Okay. Here's a formal definition. The discrete collection of vectors in a basis B of Vn can be associated with instances of the real numbers to construct the Cartesian product B cross R. If we then define a projection map pi that associates elements of R with elements of B, then the set B cross R together with the map pi is called a fiber bundle over the set of points B. And so this is giving you this. It's a very intuitive, simple idea. I guess it sounds more complicated than it really is when you try to define it abstractly, but this is the picture, and it allows you to look at these points in the vector space V5. It's sort of it reminds me of looking at the readouts on an instrument panel. You know, if you have, say, a pressure gauge, a temperature gauge, a speed, you know, speedometer, and some other readouts on the dashboard of your car, you know, those are, say, 5 discrete instruments, and each one of them gives you a number. So in that sense, the linear space of instruments on your car is represented as a fiber bundle, and if you wanted to, you could start constructing vector addition and so on. The vector space addition defined here assures you that you will add temperature to temperature, oil pressure to oil pressure, and you don't end up with oil pressure plus temperature plus speed. The exterior product and the wedge product, though, allows you to construct products of these sort of independent, unrelated variables. If you imagine this as, instead of a geometric space, imagine it as a state space of some system. How do you think the exterior algebra will look? You know, we said the exterior algebra consists of the exterior product space of V5. So the exterior product space has 2 to the 5th dimensions, and so it'll have that many basis vectors. So we're going to be able to construct a similar fiber bundle over the basis vectors of the exterior product space. Okay, I think we'll pause there. We're sort of laying the groundwork. We've come quite a long ways here in putting together the tools we need to construct the exterior algebra of a n-dimensional vector space. Hope you enjoyed this first part. Please leave any questions or comments on YouTube.